Welcome to the Endless Knot Podcast,
where the more we know,
the more we want to find out,
tracing serendipitous connections through our lives
and across disciplines.
Hi, I'm Avon.
And I'm Mark.
And today we have an interview with Carly Silver.
An assistant editor at a major publishing house, Carly Silver channels her diverse passions into her editorial work. Since graduating from Barnard College, Columbia University, in 2012, she has also worked as an ancient historian and a thoroughbred horse racing journalist. The former ancient history expert for About.com, now ThoughtCo, she has written for publications including Smithsonian, The Atlantic, Atlas Obscura, Archaeology Magazine, and History Today, among others.
A popular lecturer for Brooklyn Brainery and Nerd Night NYC, Carly also served as the managing editor and a contributor for HistoryBuff.com. Carly's career is a great example of the kind of connections between seemingly different interests and disciplines that we love to examine on this podcast. So we're very pleased to talk to her today. So hi, Carly. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here to chat with you both.
So I thought we'd start off just by kind of laying out what your background is, because we really want to talk to you about how you've connected sort of some of your academic work with non-academic contexts and things you've gone on to do. So what is your background academically?
So I always consider myself a public historian because I graduated from Barnard with a degree in religion, and I majored in religion, minored in classics. I graduated 7 years ago, and I knew that when I graduated, I wasn't going to be able to go the PhD track because the financial situation was still depths of the recession, and it just wasn't, I knew I wanted to start working. So I knew that as much as I wanted to go on to pursue my very specific passion, which was cursed texts of ancient Roman Britain, which I'm sure we can get to in a bit, knew that wasn't going to be feasible for me. And I'm very fortunate in a lot of ways, but one of them is that my mom in particular always said, if you're not able to turn your passion into your day job, find another way to make money off of it. So even before I started before I graduated, I had started freelancing as a writer for a website called Shmoop, which is, they're great. They're sort of like a fun and vibey, very chatty Cliff Notes. And I had written Facebook profiles of mythological characters. And that was a great way to get, it's a great study resource for students. And that was a great way to get started because it utilized a very millennial voice, which is something that I always enjoyed reading from, places like BuzzFeed or, really Refinery 21 or really many major publications, while also communicating the myth of the cattle raid of Maven Cahoolan. So, that was a starting point for me. And then it takes a while to find a job after college. So while I was looking for a job and interning, I just started writing more and more. And I've been really fortunate over the years with the number of publications that I've been able to work with. And my specialty is finding sort of the weird, the wonderful about the ancient world and connecting it to the modern day, or at least making it sort of fun and bizarre. So one of my favorite pieces that I did for About.com was actually the first one I ever wrote for them, was Five Roman Emperors You Wouldn't Want to Meet in a Bathhouse.
And wait. No, that would be all of them, surely.
Exactly. But and that was the fun part, was that it was hard to, pick just five. But but the fun, that both the list format and the, the sensational tales that can come out of that is such a great way to introduce somebody to the subject. And I was fortunate that a couple months ago, a professor from Cornell that I'd never met reached out to say, hey, I saw this article. It's still up on this website. I love this. I'm going to use this in a syllabus. And I was like, that is so incredibly kind. Thank you so much for your kind words. And and that was sort of an entry point for a lot of people, but also, I love the idea that it could serve not only as entertainment, but as an entry point for a student or an entry point for someone who has just a casual interest to maybe further their passion to learn about all this weird stuff. Because there's so many people have done so much great work to combat the stereotype the ancient world is stodgy, which it's not. But, if you put it in a way that a certain audience might be more inclined to read it or, listen to it like you do with your wonderful podcast, that is another way for people to consume information.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the more entry points and the more different, you never know what's going to catch somebody's interest and take them further than the thing that you've started with. And the more different directions you can do that, the better, always.
And I think it's a really important time to have this kind of material available, you know, given that, that people are so much, you know, more driven by the financial necessities in terms of their, you know, educational
schooling, their schooling, what they can do.
That there needs to be somewhere for them to turn to pursue their passions if they can't in their educational career.
Exactly. And like I said, I was very, you know, fortunate in that I was already living in New York, and New York is, so for those who may not be familiar, my day job is I'm an assistant editor at HarperCollins, which is one of the big five publishing houses. And one of the, I'd say about 70% of editorial publishing houses, like the editors, are based out of New York. And it's very, of course, you think you know how expensive it is, and then double or triple it. It's an incredibly difficult city to afford to live in. So I was fortunate in a lot of ways that I was already geographically here, but it's sort of in a weird correlation to, you know, how it can be so difficult to find a place in academia where you have to survive on such a meager salary. Publishing is not at all a lucrative field, and as so many in humanities, I mean, it's no surprise to anyone, I'm sure, but also the combative costs of living in the city are make it very, very difficult for people to come just move. And if you aren't, I mean, you're not making a lot of money. So to have to live in a very expensive city is very, very difficult. So this was also a way for me to add a little bit of extra income while also pursuing something that I was really passionate about.
And then by doing so, you're allowing people who perhaps didn't study history in university because they too had to make that choice of, well, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get a job that can pay the amount of money I needed to borrow to go to school, et cetera, from those fields. They can, I think there's a lot of good to be done by helping people who maybe studied something else but still are interested in it find their way into these things in a non-academic context.
And I think that the more people I meet just in life, the more I find that there are people that have like a secret interest in history that goes beyond the History Channel, you know, aliens in World War II, which, you know, there's some wonderful work being done by a lot of archaeologists on Twitter. Oh, I mean, they're not only on Twitter, but
I see them on Twitter. Yeah.
Discuss a lot of these matters on Twitter about, you know, how racism inherent in ancient aliens and how it's depriving cultures of their agency and actually having built these amazing monuments. So by saying that, you know, you aliens built them, you're, like I said, depriving agency from these different peoples. But, and look, that's the History Channel does its certain things, but there's so much more to history than that. Or even like a Julius Caesar, for someone like that, you know, which you're going to get, there are people that a straight up biography of Caesar is great, but you know, you take someone like Professor Barry Strauss, who was also from Cornell, and he did a great book on the assassination of Caesar and sort of like the aftermath and the fallout of that. And that was a really interesting take, I thought, on, it was just called The Death of Caesar, a different take on, rather than the life of the man, because I think that there's, I mean, there's plenty, Lord knows there's plenty of work done on both sides, but he's someone who's done a really great job, I think, of writing popular history and bringing that. And he's, you know, and there are a number, of course, number of other scholars that are doing things like that. But I've really enjoyed his work, and I actually interviewed him for about, when it was about.com a couple years ago. And he's got a new book out called 10 Caesars that's really good. And I'm not being sponsored or anything.
I've been seeing his work too. Yeah, I haven't actually read the new one, but yeah, I think that he does good work in that same way of, as you say, making
it very accessible and well-written.
Enough of a hook like Caesar or the Caesars or whatever, but then not just telling the same story that's been told every time.
And, or, you know, finding an interesting framework for it. What's so funny is, you know, if you're on Instagram, which, you know, I have like an Instagram account, I don't use it all that often, but it's a great way to, you know, see when people are traveling and be jealous of where they're going or whatnot. You're an archaeologist being like, wow, I really wish I was on that dig in Cyprus or something. But so, you know, I was joking about like, you know, I'm not being sponsored, but of course, you know, like for like celebrities and like, you know, Instagram influencers, you know, they're paid six figures to hawk like, you know, certain brands of eyewear or certain like basically laxative teas, which is, it's like a part of pop culture now. And I had this like wonderfully weird thought, like if there was like a classicist or historian Instagram, like what would be our equivalent, like paid to hawk, like some weird remedy from like one of the Plinys, like some like, you know, like frog toast. I don't remember those recipes offhand, but like, you know.
How to defog your bronze mirror if it's been looked at by a menstruating woman.
Exactly, you know, exactly. Or like, you know, some of these, you know, wonderful recipes from Egyptian papyri, mm-hmm. like, you know, or, you know, like cursed, you know.
Selling the newest cursed tablets, yeah.
Exactly. Like, you know, I mean, that would be, the thing is sometimes I just have these like funny, bizarre ideas and I'm like, well, I can't really do anything with that because I'm not going to, you know, but.
The amount of time it would take won't actually.
Yeah, I mean, I don't really think that would, who knows, maybe it sounds more like a cartoon or something like that. But, you know, it's those kind of links between, there's a very, the veil between worlds is very thin, as it were. And it's the great thing about modern scholarship is that the accessibility in terms of the way things are written and the availability is hopefully greater than ever. Less stuff is behind a paywall. There are open access journals. Twitter's a great place to, you know, mm-hmm. both listen and learn in discussions and then participate if you so choose. And I think there's a lot of interesting stuff going on.
Yeah, for sure.
So when you build these connections between the ancient and the modern, which end do you start? Do you think of, you know, this is a current issue in the world today? Well, what's the ancient equivalent of that? Or what kind of leads to that? Or do you go the other way and you just sort of think, well, what is the impact of this interesting story in ancient times? And how is that relevant to us today?
That's a really good question. And I wish I had a specific answer. I think to be quite frank, I think I wish it was like, I could say it was like a great brainstorming process. It depends on a couple things. In my case, it depends on if I'm actively looking for something to pitch. So if there's a publication that I know is in particular that I really would love to write for, and they're accepting pitches on a particular topic, or, you know, there are a lot of places are accepting pitches on a rolling basis, but there may be, you know, maybe they have a particular theme they're looking for, or they're like, there's a period of time in which they're really accepting pitches. So they're really looking for content. So that may be looking for something that's a little more current events related. So I'll, you know, start out on the modern end. I think the best example for me was the Smithsonian article that I did, which I did wrote 2 years ago that I loved, which is, it's one of the most interesting pieces that I found to research. It was basically looking at Trump's border wall and the psychology of border walls, looking through the lens of Hadrian's Wall. And mm-hmm. obviously you can't measure the effectiveness of Hadrian's Wall because it's been nearly 2,000 years. But the basic premise of it was it didn't work then. The psychology of a wall is more—it's more in the thought around it and the fear that it engenders than the actual effectiveness of a wall, and mm-hmm. of course, the then fear and intimidation tactics and looking at the rhetoric a bit surrounding that. And ultimately, I think the New York Times wrote a piece about the psychology of walls a couple of years ago, and I thought that was really interesting because that was something where, of course, the wall was in current dialogue. And it's something that was such a big thing leading up to the campaign, leading up to
2016 election.
Yeah, the election, which I've tried to block out. But I mean, I think this might have been the spring of 2017 that I was writing this. So this was still very much, and it, like I said, mm-hmm. it's still, of course, being discussed. But this was something that it was so hammered home that the parallel sort of naturally arose from whatever I was reading or working on. Mm-hmm. Other times there are, you know, I'll sort of start at the other end, where, you know, I'll come across something ancient, or which in and of itself is rather vague, but something in history where I'm reading about an artifact or a political event or something, you know, if I'm really interested in writing about it, I'm like, okay, are there any connections? Is there a way of making this relevant? And of course, it depends on the publication I'm looking to pitch to. And because I can never, you know, none of this is written in a vacuum. And of course, that's the case for everything. But I'd say everything that I'm writing is for a particular publication or a particular audience. So I'm, you know, I choose how I would want to present something. And of course, the tone in which I would present a pitch. So I think one of the instances where it was sort of parallel, that it wasn't so much that it's hard to, I remember the writing of these articles. The original genesis of some of them is a little bit lost in my brain because I'm always pitching. And I think as writers, you know, or as podcasters and creators, you always have a thousand. I literally have just like a Google Docs pitch file, but I keep like every idea that I have. And it's like, it's such a weird list. It just says like stingray spines. It says like, it says like, you know, like feet of the Sphinx, like ideas I have are just 90% of them I don't do anything with, but just to keep any ideas in. So one of my other favorite pieces that I've written in the past couple of years was a piece for a great website called Narratively, which was about one of the first cases of what we could arguably call sexual harassment in the ancient world of sexual assault. Of course, the language, so in ancient Egypt, and the difficulty in defining that as something that's something very specific is the ancient Egyptians didn't exactly have a word for what we would consider that today. So those heinous acts were probably what happened. And, you know, I very much had to like take out all of that, like scholarly, like, well, we're not entirely sure, but this is probably sort of just couching it in
all the hedging. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. Which is of course, you know, what you have to do, because when in history, you don't know what happens. You can say this is likely what happened, or I think this is what happened based on, you know, criteria. But so this was around the time when the Me Too and Time's Up movements were gaining a lot of traction in the media, rightfully so. And all these individuals were coming out to tell their stories of these horrible, horrible abuses that they had suffered. And, you know, it was something I think that I had like a vague inkling. Sometimes I'll get like almost like a tingle. Like I'm like, there's something here, a way in which I can maybe not contribute to the dialogue as such, because this is something where, you know, I just want to listen, learn, and, you know, support those who have suffered and are survivors, and not to so much speak on someone's behalf, but to use my historical lens, as it were, to show the prevalence of these awful things throughout history. Because of course we know that these things have happened, and there's so many historical examples, but the rules change throughout time, and things that may not have been written down, you know, like in certain ancient societies, things that, you know, it doesn't mean that they weren't heinous then or heinous now. It's just that the record that survives doesn't necessarily choose to discuss them. And especially in Egypt, it's such a, you know, you're not going to get that in any, you know, on a temple wall. And that's, you know, so long story short, I began looking into the records of Deir el-Medina, which of course is the village in the desert where the workmen who worked on the Valley of the King's tombs, all the artisans, stonemasons, builders, all of these people were basically like put in not a fake village, but a village in the middle of nowhere out by the tombs. And they were like had water brought in on donkeys. And it wasn't this amazing, all of these amazing, maybe like a couple hundred, you know, people. And just that was their sole job, to work on the tombs in the Valley of the Kings. And this was primarily, I'd say, late 18th, I think early 19th dynasty. And maybe I want to say through the 20th, but I don't remember exactly off the top of my head. But what was so interesting is that there are all of these legal records that survive from Deir el-Medina. And that's one of the things that it's known for, besides the incredibly talented individuals, that we have sketches and we have, you know, on a pottery shirt, we have like little cartoons, and it's really amazing. There are all of these legal records that survive from, you know, the authorities there, and from, because Deir el-Medina's daily life. And it's because it's such an isolated village and it's so dry, the conditions were ideal. It was isolated. And there was a fellow named Paneb who was recorded as having potentially assaulted the wives of several workmen. And in addition to a whole host of other crimes. So this was framed already in the existing legal discussion, you know, sent like stuff that was sent to the vizier or one of the viziers of Upper and Lower Egypt as a crime. You know, it wasn't just that he, you know, stole the labor, which was supposed to be going to, you know, basically borrowed workmen to do something for him when, you know, that time is meant to be going to the tombs of Pharaoh. That's literally stealing time from the gods, but violating individuals. And I thought that was such a horribly prescient thing to have this document, which, you know, people have talked about it, and I had a wonderful professor at Columbia named Emily O'Dell, who's now at Yale and is taught all over the world, who taught, she's an Egyptologist and a scholar of many different things, but she, I remember, had spoken about Paneb a bit as sort of, you know, this really awful guy once upon a time. And every now and then I'll go back and check, you know, I have all my notes on my laptop from undergrad. And I, you know, remembered being like, there's something here. I remember hearing about this guy who had done what, you know, like Harvey Weinstein has done, but in a different context. And so what this piece was looking at you know, the social context in which these very likely assaults happened. And it was really fascinating. It was horrifying to, I mean, it's one thing to read about it, and it's another thing to try and investigate it and really bring it to life in a way, bring this individual, I suppose, because it was ultimately trying to show the life of Daryl Medina and this these circumstances of the crimes of this man, Panev. I was really intrigued by this case because, of course, as we know, but as, you know, as the point can never be made too strongly, that horrible, horrible things have been happening since the beginning of time. And I feel like that's like such a gruesome way to talk about history. We're like, you know, going from the highs to the lows. But of course, you know, there are these kinds of things have always happened and continue to happen. So I hope that that piece both educated and intrigued, because my goal is to always listen, learn, and hopefully share my thoughts with other people and to ultimately just better educate myself and hopefully those that are reading this piece.
Yeah, I think one of the really interesting things about that piece too is not just the useful element of this has happened all through history, but also this was seen as wrong.
Yes,
in this other time. Now, of course, in a different way and in a different context, and I'm sure we could argue that probably the assaults on the women were seen as wrong because they really, you know, were a problem for the men involved and all of those things. You know, it's not the same, but to say it's not just, because one of the things about the Me Too and Time's Up kind of has been, oh, now we're not allowed to do this. Oh, things have changed. And now a man can't say this, yeah, or now a man can't something. And to say, well, I mean, no, obviously it's not a pure parallel, of course, but to say, look, there's been 3,000 years ago, people did bad things and people recognize them as bad.
Exactly.
I think that's a very valuable
element. And you brought up a point that sort of had like another bell going off in my head, because I remembered something else, that the way in which so this was like basically this papyrus. It was Papyrus Salt 124. It's just how it's categorized. They didn't call it that back then. It was basically a draft. What they found was a draft of a letter. And of course, mm-hmm. the final draft of that letter was presumably sent onto the vizier in the capital. But the interesting part about it is that I had mentioned before, like, you know, Panev was accused of all these other crimes, like stealing workmen's time. Mm-hmm. This was listed as like among the accusations of crimes. And again, there wasn't necessarily, I mean, there are lots of different things that he's listed. He's, you know, basically gave servants that maybe didn't belong to him. There's a whole backstory to this of like the guy who's writing this feels that Panev has like robbed him of his family legacy, of his hereditary like workman's chief position. And so he has an agenda to begin with, of course, which does not by any means decrease the value of the accusations he's making, but it's just interesting to know the point from which his perspective. But what he's basically saying, he's this fellow named Amenach, he's saying Panev is, he became one of the most powerful, I guess, workmen in this village of workmen. Mm-hmm. And he's saying Panev doesn't deserve any of this power, not only because some of it's mine by hereditary right, but look at all these things that he's done. He's given away servants that belong to my father, to my family. He may have bribed somebody. He stole Pharaoh's time by, you know, because the time that's supposed to be devoted to a Pharaoh's tomb. And he assaulted, you know, the wife of so-and-so. He had sexual relations with the wife of so-and-so. His son also had relations with the same woman. So this is all framed in a sense of all of these things are wrong. Mm-hmm. It's not necessarily clear how Amenach, the writer, regards as like, well, which is worse, which is, I mean, you might think that what's, you know, listed first is perhaps most egregious, but again, it's hard to know. I'm not an expert in ancient Egyptian jurisprudence. There are those who are experts in that field, and I would cede this argument to them. But the fact that it's included important enough to mention, and like you said, it's not a petty crime. It's not just something that could be under the rug. And, you know, I would like to think that, you know, there's been a lot written about gender equity or in ancient Egyptian society. And there's certain examples that, especially legally, women had a lot more rights. There's, of course, certainly was not gender equality, but they had it better than they had in ancient Greece, which is
high bar, but yeah.
No, it isn't.
Yeah. No, I know what you mean. They do seem to have particular property rights and marriage and things like that.
Exactly, some legal rights. But what was also really interesting about those accusations in the context of the instances of adultery and sexual assault, which are sort of lumped together, is that these are not only things that the way Amenach frames them is that these aren't only things that are bad that Panev did, but because the Village of the Workmen is its own social entity, there are social disruptions. By having sex and or assaulting the wife of so-and-so, he is assaulting his coworker's wife. So in the mind of Amenacht, who, you know, this is all, you know, a village that is supposed to be just, devoted to working on the royal tombs, this is upsetting the social order of a manufactured village, meaning that it's artificial in the sense of these people were brought to a village. Mm-hmm. They all have like this basically work in the same sort of field towards a common purpose. So if the pharaoh's goal is to have all of, you know, these people working on these tombs and they all live together in like the middle of nowhere, it's like on Gilligan's Island. Imagine if they were all on Gilligan's Island, basically, and then someone started doing this bad stuff. You're not going to be able to get all, you know, your end goal. Mm-hmm. So it's disturbing this artificially imposed social order, which of course it still makes it, it's still just as horrible. But I think part of his argument was that a part of the, you know, the argument in which Amenacht presents this argument, these deeds to the vizier, is that he's doing all these things that upset the social order that was imposed, or that, mm-hmm. or even that any society would regard as heinous. But it's particularly heinous because we all have to work together towards this common assignment, and we can't do that. And, you know, the issue is that the concept of consent in ancient Egypt is that there's no like word for consent, but we don't know whether or not the women mentioned, who are rarely given names, usually the wife or daughter or so, and so provided their consent. But it's not inconceivable by any means to think that Panev or his son Peti would have assaulted mm-hmm. these individuals. You know, as we've seen, this is all too common and all too, you know, of course you have to contain the caveat that just we don't know, but you know, it's all too prevalent throughout history that individuals of any gender have been assaulted or have assaulted in a sense. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, it's a really interesting connection, and that idea of an artificial group all working together. Of course, as you said, like you framed it as workplace or as a boss, and I think that's really an important mm-hmm. part of it too, because it's about a workplace and being disrupted power. And the power differential and
exactly, which and in the fact itself that, is disturbing.
Yeah, exactly,
because it's not like a human right. It's basically the narrator of the letter is saying, this is all happening in like a place devoted mm-hmm. to labor for the king. So the reason that it's such a problem is because it's making people argue and it's disrupting the social order in this place that's meant for the king's use.
Yeah. And then,
and I think in much the same vein as like, you know, the Panev is accused of maybe stealing a couple things from royal tombs mm-hmm. or like incense or, you know, misappropriating labor or things like that. It's in the same, not in the same vein, of course, by the way we think of it, but it's also stealing like harmonious relations that belong to the king, because the time they spend arguing, they could be working on a tomb or doing something else. Mm-hmm. There is one instance of a woman named Yeyemwa, where the word seems to indicate that he, Panev, stripped her and violated her. I don't remember the use of the word for violated, but again, the violence of certain language, mm-hmm. you know, definitely suggests, could very well suggest assault and harassment or any combination of these heinous acts. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's a very interesting piece, and we'll link, by the way, in the show notes. And
oh, thank you very much
to your main website, which has a lot of these, but the ones that you've mentioned, we'll definitely provide links so people can go check them out because they all have details.
I hope so. Yeah, I may have basically just like given away the entire thesis of the article, but I think
still worth reading. So,
yeah, I hope so. I realize that, you know, sort of by over explaining it, but the beautiful illustrations by the people and the artists and narratively, right. They did a really beautiful job of bringing it to life. So, but you also get what's so interesting, and then I promise I'll leave this letter alone. This is one document. Mm-hmm. It's such a fascinating, there's so many lenses through which you could look at this. You know, and I spoke to Egyptologists and, you know, sort of, there's allegations that Panev has bribed viziers and has maybe even been in touch with Pharaoh to get viziers fired. You know, so the levels of corruption, mm-hmm. in addition to the allegations of sexual assault, is so, there's so much there. And who knows, you know.
And we don't know what happened, of course. That's the frustrating thing with so many of these kinds of cases. We don't know the outcome.
And there are some implications, and definitely I won't say, read the article to find out what we think happened. but what's so also interesting is the narrator, Amenacht, who wrote this document complaining to one of the viziers, also was his brother, who was a prominent official, had basically raised Panev, was like Panev's foster father. So there's all, again, it's so internecine. The links are so,
it's sort of convoluted. Yeah.
It does. And it makes it that much more fascinating and complex.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, it's a great story. I mean, the Egyptian documents are both in the Egyptian pharaonic period and then later in the Greco-Roman period. You have, because of this preservation that you have in Egypt, such fascinating things. And so often you get like only one side or part of a story and not the whole story. And it is so, it's so fascinating and informative and at the same time, deeply frustrating.
Because the historical record, I think, for any era, any place, is that by nature, I mean, you're going to get an official record many times that's set down by the victors, as it were, the people in power. But then you get these tantalizing glimpses of life for whether it's your average Joe or, you know, your or of material culture of things that aren't represented or maybe directly contradict things that are written in the quote unquote official record. Or that's what's so alluring to me about so much of history and so much of is that it both isn't what you are told, you know, what you're taught necessarily, and you'll never exactly know. We can suppose, and I mean, unless with very few examples, a lot of, especially of course, the farther back you go, there are certain things, you know, with regards to specificities of certain historical incidents, we may never know. And we can know 99%, but the fact that there is always that room for discussion, interpretation, and further understanding is both infuriating and fascinating to me.
Yeah, for sure. Is that interest in those kinds of corners, you know, the bits that are harder to get at, is that what led you into being interested in cursed tablets, given to go back to that point?
So so the cursed tablet thing, that actually was, I've sort of always been, I mean, something like a Hadrian's Wall, for example, that's a pretty literally big and figuratively big matter when all of that comes with it. I chose to major in religion at Barnard because I wanted a lens through which I could examine multiple fields. I was a classics minor and I really was doing a lot of work in classics, but I wanted to be able to, you know, learn as much as I could about many different cultures through the prisms of anthropology and faith and ritual. And of course, you can do that in many different fields, but this just so happened that for me, it was the right choice. And I got to take many fascinating classes and things that have nothing to do with what I research now, but I just love to learn. And of course, I think that's the case for you both as well. And anyone who's listening to a wonderful podcast like this, we love to learn, which is why we, you know,
spend our time doing it.
Exactly. So it was funny because, you know, in like my thesis seminar in college, you know, a lot of people are looking at, most people are looking at modern religion or maybe a couple centuries back. It was very funny because, you know, you have thesis partners, like, you know, editing partners. And I had no idea what they were talking of in terms, like, I had no context for this person's research. But, you know, by just sort of existing in this world, you may have a little more context for, you know, and talking about modern evangelicalism versus ancient Roman curse tablets. So sort of a funny, it was a very weird, and I'm grateful that the Barnard department and my advisor, who's Professor Elizabeth Castelli, who's still the head of the religion department there and is a wonderful scholar of early Christianity, allowed me to go down that route and and sort of get my ancient nerd on. So what I was always, I've always been fascinated by Roman Britain, regardless, before my own academic interests, whether it was Rosemary Sutcliffe reading historical fiction, which is, you know, I'm very avid historical fiction reader now, or Arthurian legend and, you know, the end of the Roman Empire supposedly giving rise to Arthur, and Roman Britain, sort of the juxtaposition of Rome, which I sort of saw as something very different from Britain as I thought of it, as like a concept. I always thought of the Roman Empire, then the British are involved somehow. So the more I came to learn about it, the more I've been fascinated by sort of the frontiers of empire. And there's been so much great work done on the frontiers of empire and the way culture interacts and hybridization and things like that. So I started, I've always been fascinated by cultural hybridization, where, you know, two or more cultural concepts really fuse to produce something new that has traces of both. Now, of course, you can't necessarily trace the individual strand saying this is Roman, this is British, especially when we don't have any written records from the quote unquote British who live there. Again, it's a very retrojective term, but insofar as, and of course, the limits of scholarship are many, but So I started looking, I knew I wanted to focus on Roman Britain or thereabouts. I also briefly wanted to write about the horse goddess Epona, mm-hmm. who is in Gaul, but then I realized, oh, I don't speak French or read French. So that will be very difficult for me. So there was also the factor of, you know, mm-hmm. language limitations. So, okay. So this, you know, I was going to focus on Roman Britain. So I started looking around, you know, there's lots of, or just sort of poking around in terms of what I wanted to write about or wanted to really learn about. I don't remember what I was doing. I think I must have been in like one of the computer labs or something. And I was reading something about Bath, which is, for those who may not know, is a wonderful town in southwestern Roman Britain, southwestern Britain. It's still there, where it was Aquae Sulis in
Roman times. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And it has these wonderful mineral springs where people would go and take the waters, and the springs are still there and still believed to have curative properties, wonderful minerals in them. And I came across these things called curse tablets, which I had never heard of. I'd been somewhat familiar with ancient magic or mm-hmm. cursed spells and Greek, you know, the Greek magical and erotic papyri. Mm-hmm. But I was like, there's a particular cluster that was at Bath. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I don't know what this curse tablet thing is. I don't know why they're all like at this place with all these springs, but I am fascinated. And I went down the proverbial rabbit hole, which I think is how a lot of us find our mm-hmm. passions. Long story short, these basically were very, throughout the ancient Mediterranean, they're from like, I'd say like maybe 400 BCE to like 400 CE. Again, we're very vague intentionally because I don't have the records in front of me at the moment, but there were, you know, basically on small pieces of lead or lead derivatives or dark metal, messages were scribed to the gods, generally probably by, you know, a scribe you could hire. And they were oftentimes pleas, whether for to bind a loved one so that they loved you in return, or to curse somebody and ask the god to do certain things to them, or to retrieve a lost item for the god to retrieve something. They use this very formulaic language that you can see the same types of terms, you know, like may, in the case of a stolen item, you know, may the god punish the thief, whether they are slave or free, man or woman. One instance we have basically pagan or Christian, but the sort of the veracity of that is a little bit, it's hard to tell. And so this culture of this ritualistic language peppered all of these, you know, these curse tablets, you know, as, you know, Hellenization and then Romanization spread, and, you know, the language was brought with cultural practices. So in Bath, you know, it was this place where before the Romans and during Roman times, people would come to take the waters. And at the bottom of this pool, one of the pools that was sacred to the goddess of the place was drained, I think in the 70s. And they found all these lead tablets at the bottom of it. And so there's been amazing work done by, I believe Barry Cunliffe is the professor mm-hmm. and the archaeologist who has done a lot of the writing and work on this, deciphering these tablets. And they're not uncommon to find at sites of water. There's a lot written about Celtic, insofar as we can use that word as a singular definition, but
the Celts only stretched from the Black Sea to Ireland. I don't see why we shouldn't.
No, because exactly, for more than that, there's a really great episode of In Our Time in which they're talking about the Celts, and Mervyn Bragg keeps trying to use the word Celt, like Celtic describe things, and the scholars are just like, nope. Anyway, Anyway, so I use that very, very, yeah. very loosely. But so they found all these cursed tablets, and there are a couple throughout Britain, but the largest singular cluster was found at Bath. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot written of people's, you know, British people's depositing things in ritual bodies of water. And so these were deciphered. And basically most, you know, there were some of this format, you know, lead or lead derivatives or dark metals. Like I said, there was love magic. There were things about chariot races. There was cursing. Almost all of these were asking the goddess of the place to punish a thief that had stolen something. Mm-hmm. So they were almost all about theft. And I actually did the math of counting all of these down at one point and coming up like with what the percentage was that dealt with theft. Some of them were just lists of names. Potentially names of thieves. And so what I was looking at, and I examined, there have been more discovered in the years since, but almost all of them throughout Britain, even in Uli's another site, I believe I'm pronouncing that correctly, and elsewhere, almost all of them to a T deal with issues of theft. When elsewhere, you know, they deal with the subjects range. And so I was left really confused, being like, well, is there like a really, really bad theft problem in Roman Britain? Like, but like that none of these other provinces seem to have in the archaeological record. Like there isn't, you know, I feel like someone would have mentioned this. I mean, and of course people have, but so I was left with this very confusing conundrum of what do I do with this? There's this cultural hybridization of the the format of the tablet and the language that's used. Of course, the language here is mostly Latin. There's maybe one example of written British, but we're not sure. But they're talking about something that very rarely concerns other people. I mean, mm-hmm. So I started examining the cultural context out of which they are produced. And there I found my answer, which seemed to be that a lot of these were what Professor Christopher Faraone calls prayers for justice, which is like a separate cursed tablet. It's like a sub category of cursed tablets. And he's a wonderful scholar of ancient magic, Greek and Roman. I actually got to meet him at a conference once, and like I walked up and said, hi, I basically loved your scholarship. And he was like, oh, thank you. And I was like, but you know, it's like when people like, it's like, it was like meeting a celebrity. He was lovely. It was like, it was very like, I couldn't tell him how much his work had meant to me. And it was, anyway. So basically these were a category that he calls prayers for justice, in which the individuals beseeched the god to pursue justice on their behalf, and you know, whether it's justice in the courts, justice in, but here things were stolen. And so the thinking, the theory is, and this is other people have articulated this, and this is what I think is probable, that a lot of the individuals going to these Roman baths, there were people of all different statuses, but you would have the place where you'd go change and like put all your little, like your cloak, your underwear, you'd basically strip and put your stuff in a cubby. And unless you were wealthy enough to have a slave guard it, it would be very easy for people to come and steal. Mm-hmm. And this is not a particular, I mean, people would very likely happen very often. So people's stuff would get stolen. And chances are that there were a lot of, you know, there was a culture of coming to these baths way before the Romans and way after the Romans. So, you know, there were Native Britons, of course, people with from all over coming, but it wasn't just like a baths for the wealthy. So you'd get a lot of people with like very little small things stolen. So when you know, there really was no police as such. And there chances are also, if you were a native Briton, you may not have been taken seriously. If you went to go,
you didn't have standing in the court probably as well. You probably couldn't use courts.
Yeah. And also you can't go to some, if you're going to you have to hire an advocate and go to court about a denarius, mm-hmm. you know, you would have to be able to afford that. And, you know, the things that were stolen were such comparative triviality to like, you know, it wasn't like a murder. It wasn't, or something like it wasn't.
To get back to the question you had before in Egypt, it wasn't something that was disrupting the community in such a way that the authorities would actually step in.
Exactly. Basically. Little things being nicked. And we don't even know if in this case there was an authority that
would have cared
anyway.
There was
a priest in the temple. And we don't necessarily know, because we don't have the records from the Britons themselves of, you know, whereas conversely in Egypt, we literally have the record from the Egyptians. Mm-hmm. We don't have the victims speaking. But what's interesting in the British case, what we think we do. So what happened was when these little things were stolen, because these Britons or Romans or whoever, the poor really didn't have any place to turn to either get their things back or get retribution for the theft. Mm-hmm. What happened is that it would be very cheap to have a scribe inscribe a cursed tablet. And most of these tablets would say, you know, to the goddess, generally it's Sulis Minerva, who's the Sulis is we think is the British goddess of the place. And Minerva is, of course, her Roman counterpart. Say, to Sulis Minerva, I dedicate whoever stole my cloak pin, whoever stole 5 cents from me, whoever stole. In one instance, may mention a name, which some people think is a slave girl. I think that would probably merit something more substantial than a curse tablet, but you never, I mean, you don't know. We think that it might be a proper name, but not entirely sure. I dedicate whoever stole this to you basically as tribute to the god. The thief is tribute. Okay, so I made a chart years ago with everything on it, all of the numbers of the tablets and what the content is.
Right.
So, and then I did all the math, which for me was not fun. Okay, so to resume. So you ask that the goddess wound or punish the man on their own terms. And basically, because generally you'll like dedicate something to a god, like a goat or a pigeon, or, you know, a sacrifice of some sort has to be made. The thinking here is that these people would say basically to the goddess, you keep whatever, you find this thing, you keep it. It's a basically a finder's fee. If you find right. the rug, the there's one that's rug, or like we think it's maybe more of like a cloak or a blanket, because mm-hmm. not really sure why you'd bring a rug. Maybe it's a towel. Like if you find my cloak, you can keep it. And that is the sacrifice that I'm making. But it is up to you as a goddess or in whatever deity may be dedicated to of vengeance to seek that individual out.
And
so, yes, exactly. And so
interesting.
And so, and what's really fascinating is that in a lot of cases, there'll be a bunch of names listed. And sometimes it's just names. Sometimes it's, you know, the plea to the goddess and the names, or sometimes it's just the plea. And what we think that these are names of potential suspects, people they think that may have stolen their items potentially. Or, you know, maybe witnesses or, you know, mm-hmm. so it's goddess as not only vengeance seeker, but goddess as detective, which yeah. is such an interesting
Okay,
attribute.
Have you written an article about that? Detective stories of ancient Britain? Come on.
I actually for Eidolon, believe it or not, wrote a piece about ancient Roman mysteries, importance of mystery novels.
Yeah, I remember that.
Writing mystery novels set in ancient Rome. So I've written something close to that, but
Minerva Sulis Minerva, the first Roman detective. Yeah.
You know what? There's been some really good mysteries written about ancient Roman Britain, especially Ruth Downey's and a lot of really good ones. But it's so interesting because, you know, again, there's so much room for interpretation. Mm-hmm. The idea of just these names, or, you know, in some cases, maybe the life of the criminal is the goddess is to take as she sees fit. There's one where, you know, the individual whose name is Civilis or Kit Willis and properly pronounced would be asking the criminal to lay down their life in the temple, basically meaning the goddess would enact punishment unless he or she, the victim, returned his plowshare. and there are also, you know, use of these repeated formulas that you see on cursed tablets and in some legal documents throughout the ancient Mediterranean, whether slave or free, whether man or woman. Mm-hmm. So basically allowing the goddess parameter to search through everybody. So the fewer restrictions you can place, the mm-hmm. better. And so by saying basically,
this could be anyone, go find them, take it.
Exactly.
Them
but yeah. but the more specific you are, presumably whether with names or with, you know, social status mm-hmm. or anything like that, the better, the more clues you're giving the god or goddess. And there's one in which like the criminal or the purported thief is the one given. There's also instances in which is very common to sort of some love curses or this kind of stuff is quite common in curses in general to not permit him to have an eye, which I think that means vision or general health unless he presumably unless he gives this thing back where you catch him. And then also to curse him with blindness or childlessness if you don't get this thing back. I mean, there's a lot that's left to be said here. And of course, you know, these are very small. I mean, like inches. I actually was fortunate enough to hold one. I went to Bath and did research. I had gloves and all of the proper, you know, but to be able to hold their, you know, they can fit in your palm. So of course you'd have to hire a scribe to know how to write that small. Mm-hmm. It's fascinating. And so this was the topic of my research. And I found, you know, these glimpses into the everyday lives, as I put it in the Eidolon article, your average Quintus mm-hmm. was sort of just because I like that turn of phrase. And, you know, you're in Roman cases, because we may have more documents in cases like this of a curse. But this is maybe one of the only instances in which we see British voices coming out. Mm-hmm. You know, they might be in a Roman, in a Mediterranean context, like format, the cursed tablet using Greco-Roman language with these formulae. But we think that these, you know, there are a lot of names that are, you know, names that are of Britons that are very specifically quote unquote Celtic. And, you know, there are definite examples. Like there's the famous, the handwriting from, on the wooden tablets from Vindolanda. Yeah. That's some of the earliest actual writing. I'm not claiming that these are earlier necessarily, but this is all part of an interactive culture that's both the means of committing something to a tablet here means something very different than that famous party invitation. It doesn't mean it's any more or less important. It just means the status of these individuals probably was a lot less. Mm-hmm. And obviously because to write that, that famous birthday invitation was probably from, we believe, someone quite wealthy. The fact that the poor, we presume, or those who couldn't afford to, you know, have somebody look into the disappearance of their plowshare or their cloak, or their horse blanket in this case, you know, they're letting their voices be heard through this ritualistic formula is fascinating to me. And I think that it's one of the so many amazing things that archaeology has and archaeologists continue to offer us is this window into a lens that we don't see. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing I love about modern historical fiction is that because you can't necessarily recover all of this, there are lots of natural gaps that you can, a brilliant author's recreation of what life may have been like through a Roman mystery novel or, you know, because mm-hmm. justice knows no boundaries and what these people are pursuing, what these detectives are pursuing. So in a Stephen Saylor or Lindsay Davis or Ruth Downey book, you know, you get to see different strata of society and that very well could be some of these people that we come across. And in the case of one of Ruth Downey's books, which is set in Bath, literally we may meet some of these people. Mm-hmm. So I found it a really interesting way to sort of cross the classics and religion bridge.
Mm-hmm. Just, sorry, as an aside, have you ever read the Gary Corby Athenian Mysteries?
I have. I enjoyed them very much. I loved the Socrates link.
Yeah.
I thought that was very, very clever. That did not occur to me because I'm not going to say what that link is, but
yeah,
I mean, not really a spoiler, but
no, but just the idea, you think of Socrates as being like this, I mean, we know he married and stuff, but as this like solo exceptional figure in the world, you forget he would have a family.
Very detached soul, and he's like this annoying little kid and you're like, wow, you know, Socrates, he definitely came from somewhere. And that's the thing that I also love about a number of Roman mysteries is sort of a lot of people have termed it like the Sam Spade sort of dialogue, especially in like the Davis and David Wishart, who's another author, Scottish author, who does a lot of great work. It's like very chattiness. They're very like, there isn't, just because it's historical doesn't mean it has to be weighed down in stodge. Informal, and I think that is so much, and not that history in of itself is stodgy, but the language doesn't, it can be just as chatty and gossipy and dishy as a BuzzFeed article or as a, you know, a 1940s detective's, you know, novel. It's just a matter of how you see it.
Yeah. I also like the SPQR series.
That's Maddox, another really, there are a lot of
John Maddox. Yeah.
That's another really good one. I'm trying to think. Rosemary Rowe, also, who's a British author, has some good ones.
Yeah. I mean, they're manifold. There are so many.
There's literally a website called The Detective in the Toga that chronicles all of these.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I don't know if that's up to date, but I mean, there are plenty of them. And I think that there's also been a number of Egyptian ones written. And in my opinion, I mean, that's one of my favorite subgenres is, you know, Roman mystery in particular. Historical mystery is a genre that, or subgenre that is very often, is sort of relegated to cozy, which is not necessarily, not that that's a bad thing. Cozies are wonderful, but I think that there's a lot of historical research that goes into them, and a lot of wonderful historical knowledge and supposition that can be gleaned from these as a resource of historical imagination.
And I'm aware of one audio drama that
really
works the same way. It's Cicero as detective.
Oh yeah?
Really? What's
from,
that
from
one?
Big Finish. I think it's just called Cicero, the series.
Yeah. You've told me about that and told me to listen to it, and I haven't yet. That's right.
I will have to listen to that. I did not know that. I know that I've read the Robert Harris's Cicero trilogy, which was wonderful, but I did not know that Cicero is, because see, that's so good. I love that they're, you know, that's, of course, there's such a rich historical legacy to tap into that you can just go crazy with if you want. I'll have to thank you for mentioning that. I'm gonna have to listen to it. Paul Doherty, who's a British writer. He's written Roman, he's written Egyptian, he's written, my favorite is his Egyptian series, the Amarok series, highly recommend. But he writes a lot of medieval, he's very prolific. So if you have a period in time that you like reading about, chances are he's written a mystery set in that period of time. I was disappointed that Agatha Christie only did the one because that one was really, really good. I think was it Death Comes as the End?
I think that's right. Yeah, I think that's right.
I think so.
And she of course, like you or whatever, is somebody who had real scholarly credentials in that and had spent a whole bunch of time as an archaeologist. And
the fact that my name is even mentioned in the same breath as hers is more than I deserve. But she, you know, she is someone that I would have loved to see her do a whole ancient set thing. Because the deliciously creepy family dynamics the social dynamics that are so great about her contemporary mysteries really come out in Death Comes as the End, and it's so good, and it makes me wish that she had written
more. No, I agree.
But, you know, at least, you know, we do have the one set and some contemporary archaeological sites. And of course, as you mentioned, the Elizabeth Peters, the Amelia Peabody books. Oh, I mean, they're
ludicrous, but I love them dearly.
they're very fun. Yeah. I always have a soft spot for Ramses, the son.
Oh, who doesn't?
Especially baby Ramses.
Yes.
Like so ridiculously precocious.
And what I particularly love is Amelia Peabody's dislike is not quite the right word, but like her non-maternal feelings towards her son. She's like, yeah, but why would anybody? No, of course you don't want to spend time with Ramses. Nobody wants to spend time with Ramses. I mean, she loves him dearly, but she finds him deeply irritating. And I identify with that sometimes.
I thought that was so interesting because, you know, she's the polar opposite to her sister-in-law, Evelyn, who's very maternal and doesn't really want to be out in the digs, even though she's a talented artist. But Amelia is much more about the digs. And it's only when Ramses really starts to, I mean, admittedly, he is incredibly precocious in the books, but that he starts to really engage that she is
interested in
really has me interested in him as an individual. I thought, you know, there are a lot of ways in which that certain series is also a lot of problematic, but I'm not saying that it's, you know, a byword for, or it's a standard of anything, but it was such an interesting way of framing the character, because of course the character of Amelia Peabody in her fictional world busted so many doors and so for her to, I thought it was such an interesting twist, and I was very happy to see that, because it's not something that you often see. It's usually either, you know, the character, the heroine has to have
children
or has to settle for somebody. And the fact that she and Emerson meet where they meet, and without, I'll go read the books. I think Curse of the Pharaoh is the first one, or no, maybe it's the Mummy. I don't remember, but I can
never keep the title. I like the title.
There's a lot of them.
She ends up having a good relationship and one that isn't constrained. But I also just like that she can have a child, but not be forced to be
maternal. And not have that be her defining. not have that be her defining role. But also the fact that she has a romance with a man who is her equal on every level, intellectually, and in turn, although he's very much a product of his era, is not only adores her, but
is willing to argue with her on intellectual grounds.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And she is just as brilliant as he is. And they are.
Oh, yeah. No, they're a great couple.
Anyway, so,
I mean,
so
it's a romance book. So they have all the romance novel sort of elements to them, too. But I really like
it. But I think it is, you know, all too often that in any novel that the span of experiences of a heroine, whatever that might be, that, you know, her emotional experiences can be so different, especially something that's set in that, in her, you know, in a Victorian and an Edwardian
time,
period. It's rare that you'd see that in any, even something that isn't historical, that, you know, a woman as a heroine, she's not only allowed to break, you know, barriers in terms of like, she's a, you know, female archaeologist in the story, but she's also feels differently than one might portray a heroine. I thought that was really interesting, and
it's really attractive.
I thought it was just very, it's very different from a lot of things that you read.
I agree, and funny, so I'm there for it.
it always got me when the Ramses always called the cat Bastet. It was never just the cat. It was just,
or Bastet. It was always the cat Bastet. Bastet is coming with us, isn't he?
I know. that's the thing about series that I love, whether historical or anything, that the little touches that endear you to those characters and make them so real. It's just, you know, or like it's when Emerson rips his shirts.
Yes.
Or
another
shirt gone. Or, you know, like, good dad, Peabody. Or, you know, something like that. It's just the little touches that
make
it.
The value of formulaic writing, too, to get back to the curse tablets, which are very differently formulaic. But, you know, those books are formulaic, but in a way that you love coming back to the things, you know, the little bits that are recognizable and they mean and they help punctuate. It's actually reading things like that, like romance novels or something, but like a series like that where everybody has their catchphrases and they start to build up and there's certain sort of punctuations to the story you start to recognize, I think is actually really useful for thinking back to a lot of ancient literature and the stuff that we see as repetitive in ancient or medieval literature and boring because it's repetitive. We actually like it. We forget how much we like it.
I think that that's a good point. And so in my day job as an assistant editor, I edit romance novels.
And
it's something that, you know, I've always appreciated them, but to be able to, I have since beginning this job years ago, have that much more appreciation and admiration for the wonderful authors who write these books, because there are a lot of tropes or hooks that are consistently found, but they're constantly reinventing what it means to have those kinds of hooks or the circumstances in which, like, those hooks present themselves and make them continually relevant. There's, like you said, there's a reason people keep going back to certain things, and it's those who reinvent them in new and interesting ways that really catch my editorial eye.
We recently had a conversation, an interview just a few episodes back with a friend who's a romance writer who... Amelia Dillon, who writes ancient mystery. Well, as she said in the thing, she's not sure whether she writes romance novels or not because she isn't very good at giving them happy endings, which means they don't count as romance.
I think that they can still be romantic fiction. I mean, there's definitely places for... I think that...
In terms of categorization, you know, romance novel is a very specific thing.
It does. It just have to have a happily ever after, a happily for now. But I think that, you know, there's so, as we've talked about, with whether it's genres of ancient literature or modern, you know, historical fiction / mystery, there's always a place for genres to blend.
It's just that they're hard to market.
That's a whole other thing. The good thing about a cursed tablet or something is you don't really have to market it. But of course, there are a lot of, you know, a lot of what is categorized as romance, something like a Nicholas Sparks, which doesn't necessarily have a happy ending. And so therefore it doesn't fit and really isn't a romance by the romantic definition, is still, there is a romantic element to it. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of tricky things, but, you know, I'm continually impressed and bowled over by the talent of romance authors and the ways in which a happy ever after is such an important thing in life. It doesn't mean that everything has to be light and sunny, either the entire book or that the ending has to be you marry a billionaire, although it can be. And for myself, I would very much like to meet a handsome billionaire to marry, but, you know, the author, but the idea that...
I'd settle for a millionaire. I mean, sorry, Mark.
The idea that people, the freedom to create one's own future and have that be happy, especially in a genre that is largely by women for women, is so revolutionary when you think about it. And it's a genre that's so often dismissed. And thankfully, there's been a lot of wonderful art. There have been a number of really great pieces, and there's been, romance authors themselves are the best advocates for the genre because they're brilliant and they're, you know, they're know how to
writers.
Write. Yeah, exactly. And they know exactly what they're talking about. So they're, you know, there's so many wonderful people to follow on Twitter if you want to learn more about, you know, romance as a genre or romance writing. But the fact that it's mostly by women for women or individuals who identify as members of that gender writing their own happy endings or, you know, people, anyone at all really choosing to write a story in which a character that they connect to or that someone else connects to have a happily ever ending, that we as a reader, as an author, as an editor, as a just an individual in the world deserve a happy ending, that's pretty cool. And that's pretty revolutionary. And I think that that's something that writing ourselves into a novel, because by nature, you're going to, you know, relate to the main character, hopefully. And the fact that everybody in these stories gets what we all dream of is so awesome. And it's the idea of, you know, in many cases, women carving out their own space in which, you know, there wasn't space provided for them, because in the traditional market, there wasn't, you know, you create something in which you're allowed to revolutionize. And I think that that's something that I am always in awe of these authors, because their brilliant creativity and the passion that they exhibit and the talent that they exhibit is second to none, in my opinion. It's funny because it's something that seems so disparate from the thoroughbred horse racing and the ancient history. But the more I am involved in all three fields, the more connections I see. And I suspect that's the case in everybody's life, but they seem so different. And they are in many respects, but there definitely are unusual ways in which they connect.
Have you ever connected the thoroughbred horse racing to, like, say, a historical, you know, talking about chariot racing or something like that?
I have. There's actually been that's an area in which a lot of really great work has been done by, like, specifically archaeological and historical. That's sort of the area that I haven't really connected as much
in your own writing.
In my own writing, I mean, I've written and read
a lot about horse racing history in recent, and, you know, the past 100 years, 150 years, but, and especially in like horse, like the history of development of the American thoroughbred and pedigree history is really what my passion is in that area. But not as much in terms of antiquity. I'm fascinated by it, but I think for me, I don't know.
You haven't found the hook yet for
It definitely doesn't mean that I would love to write something about that, but I think that it would have to be maybe more horse focused because rather than the sport itself, because for me, the whole hook of thoroughbred racing is the animal. And so for me, as someone who loves the horse, I have to, you know, there's something about like, you know, like breeding methods in the ancient world or like how, you know, because they're training. Doing the same stuff. Yeah. Exactly. There's, you know, the same, you know, breed shaping, pedigree selections, choosing to breed this horse to that horse is going on throughout the ages. It's just a matter of
the records. What we don't have for the ancient world is the records of that. Yeah. Kind of
or, you know, stuff. Like you're breeding for something very different in a plow horse than in a chariot horse. So, I mean, I think it's very interesting. I think that it would have to be definitely a particular audience for that one, but I would definitely love to write or read more about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there was a student presentation recently at school. He was talking about the Scythians, but we went on a little tangent discussing the horses and, you know, all the, because he had a bunch of modern reconstruction of Scythian armor and stuff.
Oh,
and they always had them on horses, the drawings, but one of the other profs pointed out that just for the record, the horses they're on in these modern reconstructions are not the right horses.
Yeah.
They're too big. They're not the right, you know, they're just not ancient horses.
But one of the artifacts did show, you know, quite
several
small
of them,
horses.
Yeah. And, you know, you never know proportions when you're looking at ancient artifacts because the rules of how they portray things in art and proportions, size differences are sometimes for different reasons.
Oh,
but, you
sure.
know, on the Scythian comb, the horse, the man riding the horse, his feet almost touch the ground, you know, when he's on the horse.
Exactly. And of course,
and
you know,
may have been real.
Stirrups, do you not include stirrups?
Yeah.
Do you?
No stirrups.
But what's so interesting is that, you know, for thoroughbred horse racing, of course, what I deal with as an animal is the modern thoroughbred, which is, of course, it was bred
a very specific horse,
specific purpose for a very specific body type. So it's like, imagine like basically generations of breeding selected, like if like great tennis players only married great tennis players for like hundreds of years and decided.
And not only that, but like, great tennis players with really good serves only married great tennis players with really good serves.
Exactly.
And then there was another type of tennis player who only married people who are really good at return close shots.
That is a great way of putting it.
I mean, they are so specific.
Yeah. And so
we're breeding for a quarter miler. We're breeding for...
that's what a quarter horse originally was. And so, the refinement of that animal is so unique, and that's the same for every breed. It's you breed for something different, whether it's a practical purpose or a sporting purpose.
Yeah, so, I used to ride I didn't really ever compete properly, but I used to ride hunter.
Oh, wonderful.
You know, the specifics of hunter. You can have lots of different hunters, but we would get ex thoroughbreds sometimes. Oh, if they were still thoroughbreds, they had not stopped being thoroughbreds. Ex racing horses, though, because of course, you know, unless you're going to breed them. Their lifetime is their racing lifetime is done after 3-4 years at the most, and so there were a couple of thoroughbreds that had been turned into hunters and they were great, but there's such a wide range of different breeds, but they're so different and it's so interesting having spent time, even I don't know all the details, I'm no expert on breeding, but having ridden thoroughbreds and quarter horses and warm bloods and Arab crosses and stuff, and the vastness of the difference of temperament and shape and how much their heads weigh in your hands and stuff.
And also, the breeding for a very specific type of competition is something that's, you know, as much as I love thoroughbreds, it can make, I mean, that and other things can make them really, really annoying.
Yeah.
Make them very, or not even just hard to handle, but I mean, they're bred to be spirited and bred to be competitors. So, as an animal to deal with outside of that very narrow sphere of, because even that's a very short portion of their life on the racetrack. Mm-hmm. That's, hopefully they live long, lives and,
But they built maybe 3 hours all told in their life actually racing.
Exactly. The majority of the time, they're still just horses and you still have to deal with like, you know, imagine like we're that fictional family that's breeding for the perfect tennis player. It's imagine like they have like massive forearms or something like that. Or
and they can't wear normal shirts.
Exactly. Or like, you know, they have like really big eyes because they've developed like, you know, to go back and forth between, or like they have like bug eyes because so they can like see, like
see around corners.
Have, you know, one eye on each player on the court at a time, or like if they're a coach, I don't know. I mean, this is
yeah. So they're sort of almost become sort of freaky. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. So they're very far from the original, you know. So you, it's model. Interesting if you look at horse racing history, you know, the especially with the recent tragedies at Santa Anita, and there have been a lot of horses that have passed away following training and racing accidents. You know, the soundness of the American thoroughbred is under a lot of scrutiny, and a lot of work that's being done in the industry to protect the safety of the horse. And what that means is a whole nother thing that I am by no means an expert on, but, you know, like you said, breeding for certain traits does lead to exaggeration, especially, you know, inbreeding in racing is breeding in anything from Mendel to this is, you know, very select, but, you know, certain traits of course are exaggerated, and especially when you're breeding for, you know, there's such intense physical pressure, you know, it's a 1,000-pound body on legs that are like twigs, you know, that can, and they're, you know, going 40 miles an hour on dirt, and it's that it's a very difficult physical challenge. So the more refined the breed is, the more potentially
the more on the edge you are. You're on the edge of that's, and that's really what the breeding program is trying to do, is to get you right to the edge of being able to do peak performance without falling apart. And
exactly,
and there are one wrong step from falling apart.
And what's interesting is there's been some really interesting examples in the past of horses that have been like crazily inbred, intensely inbred is the preferred phrase. I don't think crazily is probably what they would use academically. But of those horses as influences on the, like on the breed, like I wouldn't do that from a soundness perspective, but there, these particular, I think it was a horse named Ultimus, who was like inbred to this great sprinter named Domino, who's known as the Black Whirlwind. He's very unsound, I believe, but very, very, very fast and a big influence on the thoroughbred, modern thoroughbred. And there was one horse that like this one guy just loved Domino. He's like, I'm going to throw everything at the wall and six. I'm going to get every strain of this horse's blood and this resulting foal. And of course, the resulting foal was really unsound. However, when bred to an outcross, which is, you know, a horse that doesn't have the blood of Domino or is like
related, not
exactly, you get some really positive results. Not just in comparison, but there's
just better than other types of horses.
Concentration of excellence in terms of how you define excellence is when, like you said, it's getting it right up to the edge, and that that edge is what's hardest, isn't it, as someone who really loves the horse, which is most of the industry, is that you can, if it's, because for most people it's really all about the love of the animal, that you're trying, you also want to make sure to do the best you can by the animal. And of course breeding is by no means the only, it's about the horse's development, it's about the medication, it's about training, it's about everything. But I like, no one now is doing that, is inbreeding is breeding horse brother
intentionally
horse
inbreeding sister. In that way.
No one's doing that now, and I think, you know, it's, anyway, it's part of a larger discussion around
there's a lot of complicated questions around racing, and that's only flat racing. You know, you start talking about jump racing in the UK, and the questions about animals and their welfare is so much more complicated.
It is, but you know, but the jet, regardless of, you know, soundness of the horse, the need for good off the track, you know, after retirement care is still very much there. And I think that, I mean, God, there are so many injuries there. You know, it's funny because we could talk about all the many issues classics faces. We could talk about it. There's, every industry has its challenges, Lord knows.
Yeah, no, that is very true. So, I mean, there are several other things I was going to ask you. You know, maybe we'll talk about it some other time.
Yeah, I apologize if I went off on tangents.
No. I mean, I took us down the, Elizabeth Peters route,
I love that because it's always, you know, I love connecting with people on tangents. That's the best
part. No, exactly. We're all about tangents. That is totally fine.
By the way, one of the
main contenders for the Derby this year is a horse named Tacitus. So I'm rooting for him for that reason alone.
Speaking there of unexpected connections,
I know. I was at Aqueduct. Only last weekend that he won the Wood Memorial, which is a big Kentucky Derby prep. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, okay, well, I'm rooting for him for that reason alone. Not to say rare that there's a class. Well, it's not common. I'll say that.
Well, especially maybe a classical-ish name, sure, but like an author, a historian, that's a
To be fair, there's also a major European horse out there right now called Saturnalia. I mean, they're not, it's not that uncommon. It's like, let's just say,
well, they keep having to find new names, of course.
Yeah, and then of course there are a lot of most names don't have historical allusions, let alone classical ones. So when there is one, I'm naturally drawn towards it.
For sure. So maybe let's end with one last question then, which is just to pull some of this together. What would you love? I know that you're always pitching and, to a very large extent when you're freelancing, you can't really write a piece if it doesn't have a home, right? That can be a real challenge,
yes.
Yeah, you have to, you may be able to come up with an idea, but it's not worth your time and energy investment to write something until you know that it's got at least a chance of having somewhere to go and it's the right shape and the right length and the right tone and all those things. If you could just choose a thing you wanted to write about tomorrow and didn't have to worry about where it was going to go, what would you love to write about that could, maybe connect some of these things? Had some time to research.
Ooh, that's a very tricky one. I would love to do either a book about the cursed tablets of England and like Roman Britain and looking at this cultural phenomenon of like basically us seeing like the poor of a Roman province for the first time in their own words, sort of. Or I years ago, I did this profile series for Archaeology Magazine called Iron Ladies of the Ancient World, about sort of overlooked female leaders in history. There's been a lot of great work done in the past couple of years about popularizing women in history and whose memories have been lost or overlooked. And I would love to do something, it's like a continuation of that, but specifically women in the ancient world and specifically rulers or landladies or women in power from every perspective, maybe chapters on individuals. So imagine the 12 Caesars, but like 12 badass women from the ancient world, from your Salome Alexandra, Queen of Judea, to, maybe a landlady in Pompeii, but examining the ways in which women engage with power on different spectra and different
social
ways.
Scales.
I mean, I think that not that those two things are at all different or broad, too broad or anything, but I mean, I think I'd love to.
To be able to spend the time research. I mean, half the fun of that definitely would be the research, wouldn't it?
Oh my God. No, but I mean,
spending the time with those kinds of sources. Yeah.
That's really the fun about it. And the fact that I'm able to do any of this is still kind of blows my mind because I mean, I think, I'm very, very lucky in a lot of ways, but I'm particularly lucky that I'm able to work with my passions as diverse and unusual as they are in the way that I do. My day job and my not day job. I mean, the biggest thing I imagine is, I'm sure you it is for everybody that has passions outside of the workplace. It is very time consuming. And, but I mean, it doesn't matter what it is. It can make it very difficult. But, the thing about the sort of millennial culture of have everyone has like 1,000 jobs. It's not untrue, but I was fortunate enough in my case where most of the 1,000 jobs that I have, which, it ranges from 1,000 to 500, depending on the time of, depending on the week, but that I really am passionate about what I'm doing. So whether it's I'm writing about whatever, or writing about, women in ancient Egypt, or I'm researching the bloodlines of a particular horse, for whatever reason, I'm really passionate about it. And I hope that comes across in the way that I write, because these are subjects that I cherish and really want to bring to vivid, sparkling life for a reader, whether they are, if they're picking up a copy of The Blood Horse, which is, a thoroughbred racing industry magazine, obviously there's presupposing a certain amount of knowledge.
Interest in racing, yes.
But even so, you think that the quality of writing and the relevance is still important, regardless of how niche the subject may be. The audience might be very specific. So again, you could presuppose a certain amount of knowledge and use terminology that you wouldn't if you were writing about horse racing for a major public, like the Atlantic, for example. But it's all about I have the passion. It's just about finding the best outlet to communicate that. And hopefully someone will want to read it.
Well, I mean, I think that's everyone's goal when they're trying to communicate, but it is fortunate. You're right. You're fortunate. And we're both fortunate in our own ways to be able to, to spend that time on things we care about and then share those things with other people who either do care about it or can be made to care about it.
Exactly. And I think that, you know, that's such a great thing about social media today is to be able to connect with people that care about the same stuff that you do. Because, you know, it's such a difficult, you know, growing up in a small suburban town where I was passionate about ancient history and horse racing. You know, this was before the advent of social media for the most part. But, you know, I was fortunate, like I had one of my closest friends is like was the only other. We bonded over our mutual love of horse racing because for whatever reason, we both loved it. And it's like, well, you know, this is something very specific. But the idea that you can now connect with people out there using hashtags about the same, like you're also researching the same like interesting thing or you're both doing this or both. It's such a great way of connecting people. And I've been fortunate enough to connect with folks like you and other people that are passionate about the same things that I saw as sort of unusual, and they are unusual in their own way, but it makes you feel a lot. It's really great to be able to share your passions like that.
Yeah. I don't have anything to add. I agree.
Yeah, it was a very general statement, to be fair.
No, but it is. And it is something that I, for all the, you know, all the many, many things that are horrible in the world and the toxicity of online environments, etc. Leaving all of that aside, I mean, I get great joy from finding the community of other people who care about the things we care about. And I really do.
The Twitter historians community and classics Twitter. And
yeah, no, there's so wonderful people there. And, you know, we live in a small town in Northern Ontario. We don't see a lot of people in person who are able to do these things or, you know, you have to distribute people who are interested in what we're interested in around the world, sprinkled. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't allow them to get together. But
they don't allow us all to get together, or else there'll be an over concentration of classicists in the atmosphere.
Yeah, and it does bad things.
And when we get you know, a steady stream of students, it's nice to be able to reach different kinds of audiences, right?
Sure.
Not, you know, the same, you know.
And people at different stages and who have different life experiences to connect to these things and all of that stuff. Yeah, exactly.
I think that that's one of the wonderful things that's so great about your podcast in particular is the breadth of topics and the breadth of audience that you reach. And it's something, there's something for everybody.
Mm-hmm. We definitely fall into that marketing problem of not knowing how to describe what we do, but we come at it from the perspective of we talk about what we want to talk about because we're interested in it, and people may or may not find it or be able to figure out what they want out of it.
But again, you know, from the content perspective, the sheer range of and breadth of things that you discuss makes it really engaging. And of course, your knowledge and discussion of the topics do also. I like things with broad perspectives or a range of interests. Unless if that wasn't clear from my own unique interests.
Well, and the great thing about the podcast has always been from the very beginning that we get to talk to interesting people. So thank you for being one of them.
Thank you so much for having me. It was such a joy to be able to chat with you both.
So on that note, we'll say thank you very much again. And we'll put, if you just go to carlysilver.com, is it?
Yes, it is.
carlysilver.com. You can find Carly's work. And you're on Twitter.
I'm on Twitter at Carly A. Silver and on Instagram at Bespectacled Legend.
I love it. Perfect.
I can't lay claim to the origin of that moniker that came from the British comedian Dane Baptiste referring to someone else. And I was like, that's my Instagram name. But yeah, I thank you so much for having me. And I had a wonderful time chatting with you both.
Well, thank you. And to our audience, we'll see you later. Thanks for listening.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
For more information on this podcast, check out our website, www.alliterative.net, where you can find links to the videos, blog posts, sources, and credits, and all our contact info.
And please check out our Patreon, where you can pledge to support this show and our video project. You can go directly to the videos at youtube.com/alliterative.
Our email is on the website, but the easiest way to get in touch with us is Twitter. I'm at AvenSarah, AvenSarah.
And I'm at alliterative. To keep up with the podcast, subscribe on your favorite podcast app or to the feed on the website.
And if you've enjoyed it, consider leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. It helps us a lot. We'll be back soon with more musings about the connections around us. Thanks for listening.
Bye.